What is going on, everybody? It is Treeb from Treeb Talks here. Before I get into the video, do you love money? I love money, and you can earn some money by entering Treeb Talks AAF picks now. All you have to do is leave your picks for the second game, the second week of the AAF season for all four games in the comment section down below, or you can check the link down below in the comment section or in the description down below to join Treeb Talks AAF pick Facebook group to find out where you are standing. Yes, week one is already in the books, but if you still want to enter the contest, you can and still have a chance to win. Here your prizes are either a $100 Amazon gift card, $100 via the Cash App, or a brand new pair of Apple AirPods, ladies and gentlemen. So that is what is at stake. Now, let's get into the point of the video, and that is me ranking the 8 teams from worst to best after 1 week of play. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the power rankings for week one of the AAF season. We have some film to go off of. People can't get as angry as me in the comment section. And trust me, the hot shots are not last. So ladies and gentlemen, this is me ranking all 8 AAF teams from worst to best week one power rankings. Coming in at number 8, we have the San Diego Fleet, Mike Martz's group. This was a team that I thought, at least in the video that I first put out before the season began, was going to be one of the best teams in football. And boy, if they play like how they played last Saturday, boy, are they going to struggle this season. Their offensive line gave up an unprecedented 7 sacks, the most sacks in AAF history. And the funny thing is that record might stand for a while, because 7 sacks in any game, that's impressive. Berkovici was getting eaten up out there by the Commanders. in fact, Berkovici got hit so hard his helmet fell off, and that was basically the AAF meme of the day, was when Berkovici almost got his helmet taken off. Martz ended up making the switch at quarterback and went with Philip Nelson at quarterback. He didn't look too bad, but the offensive line was not doing him any favors, did not protect him well at all. And as of right now, the Fleet unfortunately look like the worst team in the AAF. They don't really have a number one wide receiver to rely on. Their running game is not necessarily stout, and their offensive line sure as shit is not good. So the San Diego Fleet might be in for a long inaugural season as they come in 8th in Treeb Talks power rankings. Coming in at number 7, we have the Atlanta Legends. I think this is a team that a lot of people all seemed like they thought were going to succeed in this league. Now, Matt Sims got the start over Aaron Murray, and he did not look good. I believe he threw 2 to 3 interceptions, and they got blown out. I think the final score was 40-6 against the Orlando Apollos. And he got the start over Aaron Murray, and then I think he ended up getting benched, and then Aaron Murray came in, and then he didn't do too well either. The run game, the pass game, all of that was not working. The defense wasn't stout either, giving up 40 points. However, there were a couple of pick sixes sprinkled in there. I think there were 2 of them in that game. And, you know, the thing was is that Michael Vick backed out to be the offensive coordinator and to really be a part of this team. And, you know, when that news came out, you kind of felt slowly but surely this team might be crumbling. So the Atlanta Legends right now, they are in a rut, but maybe they can turn it around. But as of right now, they are definitely the 7th best team in the AAF. Coming in at number 6, we have the Memphis Express. The Memphis Express got shut out by the Iron. Now, that Iron defense, when we start talking about the Iron and wherever they're ranked, we're going to get into it a little bit more. But their defense is incredibly stout. Incredibly, incredibly stout. This Memphis offense had no answer offensively for this Iron defense. And the young quarterback in Christian Hackenberg, the 23-year-old who never started an NFL game, finally got a chance to start, and he didn't do too great. You know, a lot of people calling for his head, saying, why didn't Zach Mettenberger come in? You know, I was one of those guys, but I guess Mettenberger was on the injured list and was inactive for this game. I think that Zach Mettenberger can turn the Express around. All aboard the Zach Mettenberger hype train. You know, everybody's fucking against that. I don't know why. I'm a huge Zach Mettenberger guy. I know he didn't do terrific in the NFL, but I think his you know, where he was in Tennessee and the situation he was in, he was never destined to be successful. But maybe in this situation, take a struggling football team that just got shut out in the first week, I think maybe he could turn that franchise around. I don't know. Hopefully. We'll see. But as of now, they definitely struggled. Run game, pass game, everything. Zach Stacy didn't do everything that I was hoping that he was going to do. He did share carries. I believe his name was Pharaoh. I believe that was the other express running back that got some carries. I could be wrong. That could have been the Commanders running back. I'm not too sure. I don't really remember, to be 100% honest with that one. But the Express have been struggling, and that is for sure. And unfortunately, that leaves them at number 6 in Treeb Talks' power ranking. Coming in at number 5, we have the highest ranked losers, the Salt Lake Stallions. The Stallions went out and played the Hot Shots and lost 38-22. Double check on if that score is right. Yes, it is. 38-22, the Stallions lost to the Hot Shots. Now, on paper, you know, my last video where I was judging them off of his knowledge of who the coaches were and players were, I didn't know anybody on this Hot Shots team, but I will be damned if that Wolford quarterback is not a fucking stud. This whole Hot Shots lineup is really electrifying, but we are not here to talk about the Hot Shots, at least not right now. We're here to talk about the Salt Lake Stallions. The original starting quarterback, BJ Daniels, was on the injured reserve, so in came Josh Woodrum. And Woodrum put together a pretty solid game. I believe he went 10 for 23, 105 yards, one touchdown, one interception. It was a one-score game heading into halftime. But when they came back from the locker room, the result was that he has been hurt. I have not had any other update on what Woodrum's injury is. I just know that he was out of his pads to start the second half, and in came Matt Linehan. The Idaho boy, dude. I was hyped as shit for Matt Linehan to get in there. If BJ Daniels was in, then, you know, he probably would never had a chance. So I'm glad he got in there and got himself some playing time. He even threw a touchdown pass that seemed like he was going to be able to bring him back. But alas, not so much. The Hot Shots put together a really well-controlled drive that was just run up the middle, just draining down clock. Did a great job at doing that. Also, Dennis Erickson struggled. Struggled calling timeouts. He did not call the timeouts at the right time. The clock management was the worst part about the Stallions, at least inside the last 4-ish minutes. They didn't call any timeouts in the front end of the 2-minute warning. They let it run out to the 2-minute warning before they decided to call their timeouts. That's honestly, that's one of the reasons they did end up losing this game, was poor clock management. Also, this defense was gassed. You know, the Hot Shots have put together a lot of long drives in this game. And you could tell that this defense, it hasn't played football in a while, because, you know, there were substitutes coming in and out, in and out. You know, these guys were winded, 100% winded, and it showed. So, you know, once the conditioning steps up and once, you know, people get into the swing of things, I think the Stallions are going to be one of the best teams in the league. They definitely looked the most impressive out of any team that lost this week. So that's why the Stallions come in at number 5. Coming in at number 4, we have the San Antonio Commanders. The Commanders played the Fleet. It was a defensive matchup from start to finish between two quarterbacks that looked really decent to start the game, but really terrible to end the game. This was a defensive masterpiece. This is what the Super Bowl could have been. 9 combined sacks, and I think it was 5 or 4 combined interceptions. The Commanders have a quarterback by the name of Woodside, and I kind of like him. He did turn the ball over, I think, 2 or 3 times, but I do like what he has to offer, and I did look it up. Pharaoh is actually the Commanders running back, and I like what he has to offer as well. I think that the Commanders backfield is very stout, very decent, very good. David Cobb also thrown into the mix there for the Commanders. There's just a lot of talent on this team, and from watching them, you know, it's hard to not to root for them. I like their jerseys. Their fan base is obviously really, really passionate. I think that they had the most fans show out to a game out of any team this week. So the Commanders, they weren't a part of a really exciting victory, but a good defensive battle to end up getting the W. And it was a good thing to see. The Commanders coming in at number 4 because I was just a little bit less impressed with their victory than the other 3 teams that got a victory. So unfortunately, that is why the Commanders come in at number 4. Coming in at number three, I have the Iron. The Iron look like a team that is going to be really defensive-minded. They did very, very terrific on the defensive side of the ball, shutting out the Memphis Express, kept on getting turnovers. Their secondary looks like the best secondary in the league, at least from what I have seen this weekend. Definitely really good on not only the backside of the field, but also the front seven are really good as well, the defensive line and the linebackers. Obviously, they can't blitz, so they can't bring more than five people at a time, but they definitely looked good. They were getting after the quarterback. They were causing turnovers. They were menaces. They kept on forcing him to punt the ball, and when they forced him to go for it, they would not let them do it. Perfect bend but don't break defense from this Iron squad. 26 points still from the offense, not too bad. I would like this offense to kind of step up just a wee bit more before I put them in the top two, because there's two, obviously, you know, the two teams I haven't said. There were two really big offensive explosions this week in the AAF, and unfortunately the Iron weren't that. They were basically a great defensive team, but I'm going to have to see a little bit more firepower on that offensive side of the ball before I rank them in the top two. So ladies and gentlemen, who is the top two? Who comes in at number two? Well, I'm going to tell you, right? Coming in at number two, I have the Orlando Apollos. The Apollos went out there and put together a tremendous game. Offensive touchdowns, defensive touchdowns, everything, the whole nine yards. The Apollos went out and they did it well. Garrett Gilbert, the quarterback, I believe he threw three touchdown passes, had a really good completion percentage as well, went out, really led the squad to do good things. And of course, you know, a couple of pick sixes, that never ever hurts. Also, the Orlando fan base, they looked like they were excited to have a football team. They also had a decent showing in this home opener against the the Atlanta Legends. I think they did have a decent home crowd come out, so the fans are excited, and you should be excited. This Garrett Gilbert guy, who was quarterbacking for the Panthers for a little bit this season in the NFL, he looks like he's going to be a good starter for the Apollos in this defense if it can continue to score. And this offense could continue to score as well. They're looking a lot like the 2017 Jacksonville Jaguars, and the Apollos should definitely be a team to keep your eye on as far as who's going to win the first AAF championship. But they are not the best team, and the most impressed I was with the team, because that team is... Coming in at number one, I have John Wilford-led Arizona Hotshots. Holy moly, did these guys look good, from the offensive line to the defense, to the defensive backs, to the running backs, to the quarterbacks. And their quarterback right now, at least in my eyes, is leading the MVP race. I know it's week 1 of 10, but if you had to pick somebody that had the best week this week, it would definitely be quarterback John Wolford, who threw for four touchdowns. It was impressive. He did well. This Hotshots team just seemed to be scoring at will. Every time the Stallions found themselves a little bit back in the game, the Hotshots put their foot on the throat, and you really don't see that in the NFL that much, and you seem to see it a little bit in the AAF. They don't like to see teams come back. This isn't an entertainment league. This is pure football. These guys are going out there looking for the victory, and they're also playing for some incentives, which is something that I really enjoy from this league, is that they have incentives to play for, to get another bonus on top of their $250,000 base contract. And you got to imagine that Wolford definitely got a little bit of extra cash after his performance this last week, throwing four touchdowns and I believe just over 240 yards passing, which led the league in both of those categories. This guy definitely has a little bit of Baker Mayfield in him. He can scramble out. He can make plays with his legs. He can also make plays with his arms outside of the pocket. He only runs when he really needs to. I'm really impressed with what I have seen from John Wolford, and it definitely is earned from the Arizona Hotshots to jump from 8 to 1 on these power rankings, ladies and gentlemen. And before I go over and send you guys out the door, I thought I would update you on everybody that entered via YouTube, where you guys are placed in the Treeb Talks tournament. Coming in at the highest member from a YouTube picker is David Florio. David Florio, you went 3-1. You are currently in fourth place. However, I did not get a total amount of points you thought was going to be scored from the Stallions and the Hot Shots, which would have prevented you maybe from jumping a spot higher or two. The other guy from YouTube that ended up picking was Amp850, and unfortunately, my guy, you come in at last place, 22nd place, with a 1-3 record. You also did not give me a total amount of points from the Stallions and Hot Shots game, so unfortunately, that did not help your cause either, coming in at 1-3. So, ladies and gentlemen, also, if you're going to be picking this week's game, the game that you're going to have to pick the total amount of points from will have to be the Orlando Apollos and the San Antonio Commanders. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was my week one AAF Power Rankings. What did you guys think? Leave your comments down below. Don't forget, you can check the links down below as well. Don't forget to like me on Facebook, at Treeb Talks. Follow me on Twitter, at Treeb Talks, or follow me on Instagram, at Trey Vaughn Pixley. Also, if you're feeling so generous, you can go ahead and donate on Patreon. That's patreon.com/Treeb Talks. Also, if you haven't yet, hit that subscribe button. Click the bell icon so you get notified every single time I drop a new video. I drop new content on this channel 6 days a week. Ain't nobody outworking me. Those are just straight facts. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. And as always, you guys have a great day.